Once again, welcome into the Oklahoma's video studio. Time for our monthly chat with this lady right here, Tava Maloy Sofsky from the Oklahoma Film and Music Office. Tava, good to see you again.
You too, Dave.
You were a champ last month during our interview, fighting off cold, fighting off allergies, the flu, the plague. I don't know what all you were fighting off, but you were a champ during that interview. We appreciate you coming back, and you have brought guests with you. Who you have?
Yes. Well, right here I've got Jabee, who is a local Oklahoma actor and hip-hop artist.
He's everywhere these days.
He is all over. And then over here is Josh Hope, who's the co-creator and director of the Twister Alley Film Festival up in Woodbridge.
Josh, where are you from?
I grew up in northwest Oklahoma in a little town called Winoka, which is right next to Woodward, where the film festival is.
Okay, and you also, she mentioned the Twister Alley Film Festival. We'll get back to all the film festivals in just a second, but you're also the Windy City Film Festival, which is something that's coming up.
Correct, yeah.
And you got the Cubs hat on.
Yeah.
So, by the way, as a Cubs fan, props to the Cubs.
Finally, right?
Finally, after only 108 years.
Yeah.
So you spent some time in Chicago as well?
Yeah, I used to live in Chicago. I always grew up a Cubs fan. I think in Winoka, we had about a dozen channels, and one of them was the WGN Superstation.
Of course.
So I grew up as a Cubs fan. But yeah, I lived in Chicago after college for quite a while, worked out there. So it's also a hometown for me. So very excited for the Windy City Film Fest out there.
So lots of film festivals coming up, both from local areas, statewide, and we'll get into some national
windy
stuff
ones.
As well.
Twister and Windy. Windy. That,
very weather related.
Yeah.
Music festivals coming out. Jabee will be talking with us about the Norman Music Festival and all the things that he's involved with. You've heard recently about Tower Theater. But Tava, first, let's catch up on some things. Last week, there were a lot of celebrities in town, including your friend Blake Shelton.
Yes, yeah, right after I saw you last month, and right before I went to LA to showcase the state, Blake Shelton, along with many other creatives in Oklahoma, they were awarded by the governor, Governor Fallon. They were awarded as ambassadors, and it was an honor from the Creativity Oklahoma organization, so which I'm a board member on. But so it was a lovely evening, and it was great to have Blake in town with a lot of other actors and chefs and the Thunder manager. I mean, it was
Sam Presti, sure.
Yeah, it was a great night. So we were honored to be there. And
how was Blake in person?
Tall. He's very tall, and we have a small mutual connection. We're both from Ada, Oklahoma.
Okay.
And then my brother is a working songwriter out in Nashville, Zach Maloy, in which he wrote "Get Some," which is one of Blake's cuts. Don't think it was a hit, but it was a cut. So he agreed he liked.
Of course,
that.
It was a hit.
He liked that song, and. And then, yeah, I asked him if he ever had interest in acting because, you know, sometimes they cross over, like Joe Don Rooney with Rascal Flatts crossed over and acted in that Christmas movie earlier this year.
And so. Yes, no.
And he was a little caught off guard, so yeah. I don't know, maybe I'll give him time to think about
it. Planted that seed, huh?
Yes.
All right, so Blake Shelton was among those at the Oklahoma Creativity Ambassadors Gala. You mentioned you were in L.A. What was going on there?
Yeah, well, I mean, we were just there as we go every spring for it's called Association of Film Commissioners International Conference and like Global Finance Show.
Sounds
it's a
official.
Mouthful. Basically, it's a locations trade show and global finance show for all film commissioners around the world. So, I mean, Iceland and New Zealand and the UK and Chile, I mean, and then all the states that have film commission offices were represented there and showcasing their territory. So so we had a booth, we popped up and showcased our state on the trade show floor. And then we also had a seat on Entertainment Partners panel that was a part of the Global Finance Show, which was really cool. It was incentives around the globe in 90 minutes. And so it was super cool to be a part of some of these other commissions. And, you know, Oklahoma's incentive is smaller right now than a lot of other states. So we do have a lot of room to grow.
So what were you hearing there? What questions may they have been asking you about ours here?
I mean, people, it's educating, just like it is here on the home front. I mean, you know, it's like, I tell everybody about what we have, not just our incentive. That sometimes, as far as the decision makers on film or television projects, that's usually the first question. And unfortunately, if we don't have an incentive or it is, you know, at risk of going away, they just move on. sadly, that's just how it is because, yeah. But the other cool things that I just love talking about is our 12 ecoregions. I mean, people just don't realize what we have as far as diverse locations. I mean, we're one of the most diverse terrains in America. And I just got a call yesterday from one of the showrunners on American Gods because they premiere April 30th. And he was just kind of pat on the back and saying how much they enjoyed filming here. And
that's good to hear.
That Oklahoma looks great in these first couple of episodes of season one for American Gods, which premieres April 30th. You can see the trailer on our website, and you can see, it kind of goes by fast, but you can see a little bit of Oklahoma. They filmed up in Little Sahara State Park. We just had another film called The Jurassic Games. They filmed there yesterday. Mm-hmm. We went out for a site
visit. You wouldn't
tell
me where they were filming last time.
Oh, that's right.
So you're slowly letting it out. All right.
Yeah, well, they just filmed yesterday. So
you can say. It's a fact now. Yeah. It's happened.
And they have about, I think, another week of filming for that one. But so it's just reassurance, like hearing from a showrunner on a huge series that'll be on Stars. It's reassuring. I think we definitely kind of, infrastructure-wise, we still have a lot of growth opportunities, but just hearing that, you know, our state is so appealing creatively for these
creators out there.
It was really, really positive. And so I got to say all that on a panel, you know, which was something, a huge step, I thought. And then right before we came home Sunday, we hosted our third annual Okie Roundup, which is basically recruiting expatriates, so former Oklahomans who used to live here. Like, you were from Oklahoma, but he went off to college, and then he worked on, you know, American Idol and a bunch of other things producing in another state. And then he came home. That's kind of what we're trying to do in LA, is trying to point some of those filmmakers home. And we had probably upwards of 70 Okies all in one place in Malibu, and just educating them on what we've got. So there were producers, writers, directors. So those are the decision, you know, the producers are the decision makers, studio executives, some, you know, most from Oklahoma. They're the ones making the decisions as to where they're going to bring their next project. And then, so there's that element, but then the below the line crew, which is your technical crew, like camera operators and production coordinators and those kinds of crew positions, they can come home and their wages will qualify. So if we don't have enough local crew, like the depth of the local crew, they can tap in, filmmakers can tap into our expat roster. And so that was a success. And Dunlap Cutting, always supporting, they provided t-shirts to give out to our Oklahomans at the event. And so so thanks, Dunlap Cutting.
You mentioned incentives. The rebate program is open.
Yeah, our queue's open. I mean, we're receiving more and more applications for the upcoming fiscal year, FY18. So it's actually pretty unreal that right now we've got 12 active projects in our queue. So from the one filming now to multiples in pre-production and just starting in the next week or two, just they literally are going to be rolling cameras all the way through October at this point. And then since I've gotten home, which was Monday night, like, I'm not exaggerating, so in 48 hours, we have five new serious prospects that are looking, that want to come, two of them come scout in the next couple of weeks, and so.
How unique is that? Do they usually come all at once, or trickle in, or?
They kind of trickle in, it depends. I mean, sometimes, you know, when it rains, it pours, but we do our best. I mean, one of the big assets that we can offer to upfront is when they're trying to make their decision, like, they see the incentive and they know that'll work, but we'll build them a, Yusuf is our film and locations coordinator in the office, and he works hard to build a photo package, like a digital photo package. So we'll send them a link, and it's based on their script and their locations breakdown. So we try to get as close as we can to what they're looking for, and then it kind of draws them in, and then when they come scout, as I've said before, like the American Gods people, I mean, they just kind of fall in love with the locations and the people here. And so if we can get them on a plane here, if they can get themselves on a plane to come here and see us, then usually.
You feel pretty good about closing that deal once you get that face-to-face and they can see what we have to offer here.
Yeah, so just if people subscribe to our newsletter and our e-blasts, which are basically press releases, they'll see any new film coming in because we send press releases out every time one kicks in.
talking with Tava Maloy Sofsky with the Oklahoma Film and Music Office over there. Josh Hope, who will tell us about the Twister Film Festival and the Windy City Film Festival. But first, JB, if I asked you, hey, what have you been up to lately? What would you say? Because it seems to me that you have a series of things going on. What would you say, JB? What are you up to these days?
What would you say?
Well, there's a lot, you know. Of course, the festival. I'm still pushing my album. A lot of cool stuff happening with the Tower Theater.
Well, let's start with the album, Black Future. Mm-hmm. How has that been received?
It's been received really, really well. You know, it's the first album I've ever put out where I haven't had any, or seen or read any bad press or any bad comments.
Well, congratulations, because these days with social media, everybody's,
right,
you know, has something like, bad to say.
Yeah, they'll come for you, you know, for no reason. So, but I haven't seen or read anything, and it's just been really, really, really cool just to watch it unfold whenever, you know, you put everything, and you're, you know what I'm saying, you paint this picture, you put your blood, sweat, your heart, and your tears into it, and then you say, here you go. And mm-hmm. people can do what they want after that, you know what I mean?
That's tough to do when you work that hard and you put it out there and you realize you don't have the control over
right.
it.
Right. So it's just been cool, you know, and I'm just happy that people still like it and it's still moving. And I've gotten a lot of really cool opportunities because of it, so.
You performed at the Tower Theater, mm-hmm. The first performance at the newly reopened Tower Theater. What was your experience there? What was it like being on stage that night?
It was magical. It was, you know, I initially wanted to have my album release show there, and it wasn't ready. And so I just assumed that, you know, I would be in there one day. And so whenever they asked me to do the opening show, it was just like, okay. So really what I got to do was do everything that I wanted to do for my album release show that night for the Tower opening. And so I got to actually, because when I had my album release show, I barely knew the songs from the album. I was still learning. I didn't really have a show prepared based around the album. So I got to tour and do all these things, you know, put together a set, and then come back home with something really ready for, you know, so I got to kind of re-release my album. Mm-hmm. And, you know, it was just cool to look in the crowd and see my friends, my family, people that I didn't know, and just people who not only were excited about seeing me in the show, but they were excited about the Tower being open and getting to come in and see what it looked like, and mm-hmm. you know, just all that stuff together. It was just perfect.
So. Maybe that was a bit of a different show because you did have so many supporters there that night versus going up to Wichita or someplace where
right.
you're like, hey, I got to win over this crowd tonight.
Right.
It's almost like you're playing on your home turf.
Yeah. And yeah, that's what it was. It was just like a homecoming. And, you know, just it was just so much love. I feel like I could have just jumped in the crowd and just hugged everybody, you know what I'm saying? So. But you want to give that crowd, give the crowd that feeling like you are hugging them from the stage, you know what I mean? So, so it was cool, man. It was just cool to be able to have that interaction with people here.
Nathan Poppy had a story recently in the Oklahoman about the Tower Theater and some new operations and new shows that'll be happening there over the next couple of months. And JB, when we were interviewing with Stephen and Chad, I believe, they mentioned you among their partners as having such an authentic Oklahoma voice that you represented the music scene here so well. They spoke very highly. They were happy to have you among them working. What are you doing with Tower Theater these days?
I guess own a percentage of the Tower. So I get to be involved and help in helping to preserve it. You know, one of the things we want to do is make sure that whenever we do open the doors again, that they don't close ever again, you know. And also, I get to help with the operations and, you know, and the talent and shows and promotions and things like that. So it's just cool to be able to kind of get to be on the other side of things, because you know, we all have, I mean, especially if you live here, you've passed that building at least one time in your life, you know, say, if not millions.
Yeah. I was leaving that interview, I was on the phone with my mom talking about Tower Theater. She's like, yeah, I remember way back, it used to be a different store, and there was a TGNY in the shopping center down there. So, yeah, you're right. Longtime residents recognize it's iconic.
Yeah, definitely. Mm-hmm. So, you know, to be able to be a part and help, you know, make something that's so important and so iconic to the city come alive again, it's going to be great. And I'm just excited about, you know, what's to come, because I was meeting with Chad yesterday, and we have so many ideas and so many cool things coming. And, you know, my phone's been ringing off the hook with people mm-hmm. wanting to get in there and do all this cool stuff, and mm-hmm. we're open to it. That's the thing. Like, you come across some places and some venues, and, you know, they're like, well, we don't want that kind of show, but we want as many cool things and as many things that will help support the tower and the community to be there, because that's what helps build, you know, not only a music scene, but a community. So it's exciting.
Don't some of your upcoming acts have, which some are already sold out, I noticed, mm-hmm. by the way, but what's the, help me understand the local artist contribution, like they're gonna be doing some conversations with or something
right.
before shows? Or
right, so what we'll do is So we have a series, and it'll be in the studio, Tower Studios, and it'll be, you know, small, intimate type setting. Mm-hmm. And we have a national act with a local act. And so, for instance, the national act will perform, you know, an intimate set, and there'll be a Q&A session where the local act will interview the national performer. In my case, it'll be Merce, and I'll talk to Merce, I'll interview him, we'll probably take questions from the crowd and just kind of, like, you know, get to know him. You know, for one reason, for instance, Merce is someone who's been on an independent label, he's been on a major label, you know, he can really, and there isn't any artist, any hip-hop artist that you meet that doesn't know who he is, you know. And so he's really well-rounded, but he can help give insight, especially to local and up-and-coming performers and artists and rappers, on how to maneuver through independent circuits, how to maneuver through major label circuits. Because it's, you know, like, we don't really, especially for hip-hop, we don't have an industry here for it. We don't have a real hip-hop music industry where this is where, like, we usually get skipped over for hip-hop shows and hip-hop tours, you know. Yeah. We're trying to change that. So having Merce here will not only be an awesome show, but it'll be a chance to get an understanding of what it's like to be on the other side of, you know, booking and touring, and, you know what I'm saying? So it's just, so that's the plan with these shows, is to not only get to know the artists and their music, but, you know, help to grow the people here who are fans of these people as well.
It's like the workshops that you guys provide.
Yeah.
It's that chance to have that Q&A with an
right.
industry professional, mm-hmm. someone who's been there, done that, or going through it.
Because if you go to a concert, you usually go to a concert,
yeah,
and whenever they're off stage, you know, it's a crowd of people rushing mm-hmm. them, and it's like, hey, how you doing? Shake hands, sign something, and I'm gone.
It's
or they just dip out. You don't even get to see them or talk to them. So we're trying to change that. So
I love that. And the local act with the will the local artist also perform or open for the national?
No, it'll just
okay.
be them. So Merce and I have songs together, so we might do something together. Mm-hmm. But it'll just be them. The local act is kind of the bridge between our community and that performer.
That's
good concept.
So smart. ACM at UCO's mm-hmm. Metro Fest, which they just had last weekend, mm-hmm. and we co-sponsored a cool panel at that last weekend. But that's similar concept,
right.
but they're local, like they're students at ACM at UCO. They open for these big national acts,
yeah.
and then they can say, I've opened for so-and-so.
Exactly, yeah.
That's good for
a press release. That's good for
yeah.
you know, media and all that
mm-hmm.
stuff, to be able to say, you know, we might not know who you are, but okay, mm-hmm. you've done shows with this person. Okay, you might be legit. You know,
right.
so
right.
it definitely helps.
Another notch in their belt. Yeah, and at that Metro Fest, we actually co-hosted, like I said, with Dead Center and ACM, a panel, and it was very successful. It was, the title was Film and Music and How They Connect, because we're the Film and Music Office, and so, you know, there's so many crossovers and synergy. So I was in LA during that, but I heard it was one of the best, most, you know, sort of hearty, like, conversations, and there was a networking opportunity after. So that's
definitely
super cool.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
Josh, how'd you get in the film business?
It was a weird journey. Actually, I studied journalism, went to Oklahoma
State.
How weird?
Tell us about this.
Well, it started at the very beginning. My very first job in the entertainment side was with the Jerry Springer Show.
Wow.
So that's about as weird as you can get.
How'd you get
right
in the door?
I just dive into
I saw a posting.
Stage fights.
Right. I saw a posting for an internship with Universal Television and applied. And
where were you at?
I was here in Oklahoma, at Oklahoma State.
And Paige, who's back in the control room, went to Oklahoma State as well. So
yeah, nice. I'll
give you a shout out.
But then I got that job, and it took me to Chicago, and that led to a bunch of other jobs.
Jerry Springer took you to Chicago.
Yeah, because they filmed there.
Gotcha.
Yeah, so who knew? But it was a... I was very excited to jump at the chance to go live in Chicago.
I was about to say, it's the little things you take advantage of, though, actually, that, and especially if you work hard, who knows where it leads you, right?
Yeah, I mean, talking about the Cubs, you know, I grew up a Cubs fan, so I was always watching Wrigley Field on my little TV, and then I lived two blocks from where I was up there, so it was a great experience. Yeah.
And the Twister Film Festival, tell me about that. How'd that get started?
Well, Twister Alley, I started that with a good friend of mine, TJ Treese. We went to high school together. And we grew up, we loved movies. That was our escape of when we were bored out there. We would watch movies, and we went to the movies all the time. And since I became a filmmaker and started doing all that and going to different film festivals, I always thought it'd be really cool to try to start something back home, because there was never anything like that for me growing up out there. And I was like, that would be really cool if we can try something like that. So that's kind of how it started. Just, we wanted to give a chance to play indie films that you don't ever get to see out there, and give them a chance to show.
You're 3 years into this festival.
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
how many did you have the first year?
The first year we had about 50 filmmakers.
Sounds like a very successful start.
And it was, you know, I had been doing the festival thing for a while, so I kind of, you know, I was like, called my friends. I was like, you need to come hang out with us and get this thing going. And then the second year it doubled. We had over 100 last year. And this year we have around 200 that have already signed up and ready to come. And the list keeps on growing by the day. So we're very excited. It plays at the old Woodward Arts Theater out there, which is
beautiful
old vintage theater. And kind of the same way, where we just want to preserve the theater and bring attention to it. And it's just like it's one of the coolest experiences, I think, to film or to have your film show in a theater like that, where the old kind of vintage romantic had a little bit of an echo to it, but you know, it's like I like theaters like that. So
more information at twisteralleyfilmfestival.com. When is the film festival?
It takes place at the end of the month, April 27th to the 29th.
Okay, so people can still get up there.
Yeah, you should come up, you know, take a trip out to the country. We play films of all genres.
I was about to ask.
We kick off with student-made films. We actually have high school films from Oklahoma City and Weatherford, and one from our local girl Aspen Millage and Woodward. And then our Thursday night, we kick off with Oklahoma-made shorts. So we'll have a big party and then showcase the best Oklahoma short films made this year.
And so then why Windy City Film Festival? Sounds like you got your hands full here,
yeah,
well, among other things.
It was kind of the same way. Like, Chicago has a lot of festivals, but most of them are niche type festivals. There wasn't really a multi-genre festival like Twister Alley. And we were screening last year with a feature film that we had made, and we filmed it in Chicago, and there's really no place to screen it unless you had a huge cast or you were, you know, part of one of these niche type organizations. So we decided we wanted to start a multi-genre festival, so give people a chance to play films that don't get any other home out there.
So that is the Windy City Film Fest, or which is coming up later this summer, right?
Yeah, it'll be at the end of June.
All right, so can people still submit, or?
Yeah, it's open for submissions until May 15th, and we select all kinds of films and music videos.
Okay, what else should we know about you, Josh? What else are you involved with?
I'm a filmmaker as well. I have a new film that screened this last year. We screened it over 50 film festivals and won 26 awards for best film. It's got a long title. It's called The Life and Death of an Unhappily Married Man. It's a dark comedy, but it seems like people really relate to seeing. It's very honest, very realistic comedy, and it comes out May 2nd via pretty much every streaming
really
device. Yeah.
Awesome, congrats. Did I hear American Idol or The Voice you were on?
I did. After Springer, I worked for American Idol and The Biggest Loser and a bunch of reality shows and, you know, KFC commercials and wherever I could get a job working as a producer and assistant director and doing that kind of stuff until that kind of led to doing my own film stuff now.
So it sounds like you are across the board in the film world. What do you like best? Producing, maybe doing festivals?
I mean,
I love
running film festivals. I kind of it sounds weird, but it's almost like they're my children, getting to show these films and giving filmmakers a home. Mm-hmm. But so I love running festivals, and then directing would be my love as well. Pick that over anything.
And we're happy that you came home.
It's great to be here. Yeah. There's a lot of cool film stuff in Oklahoma and a lot of cool filmmakers, and it's nice to kind of get people together and network. And I think one of my favorite things about Twister Alley is having all these filmmakers and producers and actors hang out there and seeing the projects that develop from them meeting at Twister Alley. There's been several films that have been made and now going to be screening at Twister Alley from people that actually met there. So that's a big, you know, a big love to see that sort of thing happening.
Yeah, Yusuf from our office went up there the first year to represent, because we partner with a lot of these statewide music and film festivals, and I remember when he came home, he was just going on and on about how awesome it was and how there was just this, like, cool, it's like a cool crossroad, center of the country, I mean, literally right up there, and he just said it was really neat, so that a lot of that was kind of going on.
We get filmmakers from all over the U.S. Mm-hmm. We have some from Canada coming in, and actors, and so it's a great place to come and network. And even if you're not in the industry, you can come, hang out, watch the film, and then actually get to have a conversation with the director or the actor from the film you just saw. Mm-hmm. It's a pretty unique experience.
Getting that access. Yeah. All right, speaking of festivals, JB, back to you. Norman Music Festival's coming up.
Yes.
Same weekend.
10.
Yeah. So you gotta go.
The 10th.
The 10th, yeah. Yeah.
Actually, I don't know if it is number 10 or not.
Yeah, it's number 10.
Is it?
Oh,
okay.
The 10th. Yes, it is.
Well, accidentally, I got it right.
Yeah.
But it's the same weekend.
Yeah, you have to do both. You have to come watch films and go watch.
I was thinking, because you said it was what day?
April 27th to the 29th.
Yeah, because I think about going on the 27th and then coming back.
There you go. Mm-hmm. You should.
Yeah. And then go run the marathon on Sunday.
It'd be an action-packed weekend.
What can people expect down in Norman this year?
Well, of course, a lot of great music. One that I'm excited about is a friend of mine. He's from D.C. His name's Odyssey. And he's going to be one of the headliners for the main stage, which is going to be really cool. He plays with a full band. He has if you go to... he did a NPR Tiny Desk show, and I mean, it blew up. So he's amazing. He's really, really good. I play on the 29th at 10 p.m. at the Opolis Outdoor Stage, so I'm working on some cool stuff for that, so I'm excited.
Tava, as always, you bring in the coolest people who are doing the coolest
things.
They are
so cool, and JB, Norman Music, we have a long-standing relationship with Quentin and Sherry and the whole team, so big shout out. They wanted to be here as well today, but I knew we kind of had Norman Music Festival covered with JB being here, but we're proud to support the festival again, and we're hosting a series of panel discussions, which JB's one of the three presenters. So there's Chase Kirby is going to be talking about basically everything you need to know how to start a band. I'm going to cheat here. Trey Rick is doing a panel on music licensing, and then you can talk about your panel.
Yeah, so my panel will be on ways to promote and release your albums. Anybody who follows me knows that I'm always putting out music, and I try to be creative with everything I do, because you live in a especially like with music, it's always changing, you know, and I feel like, especially with hip hop, we just get so caught up with, you know, just upload it to SoundCloud and, you know, the rest of it fall into place. And that's not always true. Mm-hmm. And especially when you're trying to sell music, you know, you have to do what other people aren't doing. And so I've been able, like, for instance, the last thing I did with Black Future, I created a black box. And in the black box, you have 8 remixes from Black Future, and they're all on 7-inch vinyls. And so you get eight 7-inch vinyls, and they're picture discs. So each vinyl has the artwork on it, and I got 8 different artists to design the. So you get, so it's like art in the box, the music. You get a T-shirt, a necklace, you know, posters, flags, like, you know, just always So always trying to like think, outside of the box, And so with my record, I put it on a white vinyl, I did a cassette tape, so just, different things. And then for those who just release music online, there's always cool ways to release music online and promote it in cool ways, I think that sometimes we're just so used to watching people do cool things with releasing music and not realizing, oh, I could do that, so.
Mm-hmm. And the panels are on Saturday, right, Jabee?
Yes, ma'am.
On Saturday, April 29th, between 2 and 6 at Main Site in the middle of the festival grounds.
Yeah.
Very nice. Tava, anything else we need to know about?
Just real quick, looking back, last weekend we were proud to partner with the Bison Film Festival, which is in Ponca, at the Ponkin Theater, which is another beautiful old theater here in Oklahoma, and that was April 7th and 8th. And then coming up on the music side, we also partner with the Bob Childers Gypsy Cafe, which is in Stillwater, and that's April 26th. So there's a lot. Just get your calendars out, right? And there's a lot more. There's Bare Bones Film Festival coming up later this month. And so in our newsletter or on our website, you can see like the sort of events at a glance coming up. And just tune into social. And with all the films coming, there's going to be more extra calls, casting calls, crew calls. And there's a lot of music calls right now. So check our website.
Very good. Josh, good to meet you. Best of luck with everything. Congratulations on everything.
Appreciate it.
Be sure to go to TwisterAlleyFilmFestival.com for more information on that. Jabee, you mentioned all the websites and social media. Where can we find you these days? Where's the one place you send people to? Is it your Facebook page or?
Yeah, Facebook, or I like Instagram a lot now. I still do Twitter a lot. Just any of the social media, I'm always on there, posting stuff and sharing stuff. So. And all my social media is at my name is Jabee. So,
gotcha. Congrats on everything.
Thank you so much.
Continued best of luck. Yes. Tava, thanks so much as always.
Yeah, thanks.
Always
for
great
having
to catch
us.
Up with you. Appreciate the conversation.
Thanks to you guys. Thanks love y'all being here.
Thank you.